This is lecture on probability for MA 217. I want to remind you, in the beginning of the semester, we talked about probability, and we applied our intuition for probability, which worked pretty well until it didn't. And then it kind of failed miserably, and we saw in the Monty Hall problem the need for a more careful and precise way to talk about probability that would allow us to decide for sure what worked and what didn't. So that's what we're going to develop here. A consequence of needing to do that is a certain awkwardness. We are going to take our intuition and make it precise. And when we make it precise, it's going to sound really different. In particular, I'm going to give you some definitions which will seem incredibly complex and formal. And when you see how they work, you will see that they are saying very simple things in very complicated ways. That may seem kind of pointless, but as we go along, as you get used to expressing your intuitive notions in this awkward formalism, you will find that the awkward formalism continues to work when your intuition doesn't. So be patient as we give some definitions which will be unintuitive. So first of all, the physical situations to which probability theory applies are processes that you can repeat as often as you like with potentially different outcomes each time. And then the basic thing we'll talk about is the probability of an event, which is the proportion of times you expect that event to happen in the long run of many tries. That's a careful definition, but it's got some fuzziness in it, in particular what your expectation of what's going to happen in the long run is and where that comes from. So they're basically three places where that expectation can come from, and they each apply in different situations. The simplest is, we've talked about before, the symmetry principle, which says that if there are several indistinguishable or interchangeable possibilities, they must all be equally likely. So what do I mean by that? That's what happens when you flip a coin. You view heads and tails as interchangeable. There's no reason why one should come up more often than the other, so they each happen half the time in the long run, we expect. The second is the empirical principle, which says that events will happen with the same frequency that they have in the past. So when I say your chance in your next flight of crashing is 1 in 2 million, what I mean is, in the past, 1 out of every 2 million commercial airplane flights have crashed. So I expect that frequency will continue into the future in the absence of a change. The third source, we will not talk about this very much, because it's more kind of psychological than mathematical, is we can view that probability as measuring how sure you are that something will happen, that something is true. So if I say I think there's a 40% chance that string theory is right, I'm not making a claim about 40 out of every 100 universes string theory is true. I'm just assigning a number to my level of confidence. That works remarkably similarly, but is quite a bit vaguer, and we will not talk about that much. The important thing here is each of these ideas, symmetry, empirical, and certainly subjective, are models. You make the assumption that things are interchangeable. That may or may not be true in practice. You make the assumption that things will continue as they have in the past. That may or may not be true in practice. When you're using these principles, you should be aware that there's an assumption that may be partially true or untrue or completely true. All right, so how do we represent that mathematically? Here's where the really formal stuff comes in, the somewhat awkward notions. We represent these situations by a probability model. A probability model consists of two things. One is a set called the sample space. Its elements are called simple events or outcomes. It's meant to be all the possible outcomes of this repeatable process. And the second thing is, to each of these outcomes, we assign a number which we call its probability with two properties. Each probability of an outcome is between 0 and 1, and if you add up the probabilities of all the outcomes, they add up to 1. Let's see what this looks like in actual situations, and it will make more sense. If my probability experiment, my repeatable process, is rolling a die, my sample space is the list of all possible outcomes, would be the set of numbers from 1 to 6. Since, by the symmetry principle, I'm going to assume all outcomes are equally likely, I'm going to make each of those six outcomes have probability 1/6. And then you see that it is a probability model because each outcome has probability between 0 and 1, and when you add up all the probabilities of the outcomes, you get 1. Same thing with a deck of cards. If I draw a card, there are now 52 outcomes. The sample space would be that set of 52 outcomes, essentially the deck. They're all equally likely, so they all have probability 1 out of 52. Those numbers are all between 0 and 1, and they add up to 1, so this is a probability model. Those both came from the symmetry principle. What about the empirical principle? Suppose my repeatable example is I pick a woman at random from our class and I ask her party affiliation. Possible answers, let's say, are Democrat, Independent, and Republican. So my sample space has three elements in it. And then based on my survey from a year or two ago of Math 217, my probabilities, the percentage in that survey of Democrats, Independents, and Republicans was 26.1%, 30.4%, and 43.5%. So I'm going to assume in the future the same percentage of Democrats, Independents, and Republicans. Each of those numbers expressed as a decimal is between 0 and 1, and when you add them up, you get 100% or 1 expressed as a decimal. An important point here, as I said before, each of those assumptions may not be exactly right. The die, your die may be poorly weighted so that 6 comes up more often than 1. The political affiliation of Math 217 students may have changed over time. When we check that something is a probability model, we're checking that it makes sense to talk about probability in this case, not that it applies to your particular situation. So we're separating the question of how well does this model fit my situation from, is it a sensible probability model that we can work with? Okay, so how do we work with probability models? The basic thing we talk about is an event. Events would generally be represented by uppercase letters, or sometimes whole uppercase words. The event A is a set of outcomes. That is, it's a subset of the sample space. Once again, that makes more sense in examples. An event is something that can, may, or may not happen each time you do the experiment, each time you try this process. And the set corresponding to the event is the set of all the things that count as that happening. So rolling an odd number is an event. What does it consist of? All of the outcomes, or simple events, which are odd. 1, 3, and 5. Drawing an ace is an event when you draw a card. There are 4 aces, so the event, drawing an ace, consists of those 4 aces. Drawing a heart would consist of 13 cards. The probability of an event is just the sum of the probabilities in the outcomes that make it up. So what's the probability of rolling an odd number? It's the sum of the probabilities of 1, 3, and 5, which is 1/6 plus 1/6 plus 1/6, which is a half, which is, of course, what your intuition would have said, right? Chance of rolling an odd number is 1/2. Your intuition will also work much more efficiently than this definition in the case of an ace, where you add up the 1/52nd for all 4 possibilities, and you find the probability of an ace is 4 out of 52, or 1/13. Or for drawing a heart, where you add up the 13 1 out of 52s, you find the probability is 13 out of 52, or 1 out of 4. In all of those cases, it was sort of much simpler than I made it, because in all of those cases, the outcomes were equally likely. And in that case, a simpler way to say it is the probability is you just count up the simple events within the event, divide by the total number of simple events. Okay? Number of outcomes in A divided by number of outcomes in the sample space is a simpler way to say it when the symmetry principle is invoked. But in general, that doesn't work. So if I asked in my Democrat-Republican-Independent thing, what's the chance that a woman is not a Democrat? So that would be the event consisting of Republican and Independent. And there you'd add up the probability of Republican, probability of Independent, and you'd find that 63.9% of women are not Democrats. To start talking about more complex events and building events out of other events, it's helpful to talk about Venn diagrams. You may have seen Venn diagrams before in classes or just in ordinary life. They're a good way to represent sets and their relationship, and they're particularly helpful in the case of probability. So here's the kind of Venn diagram you might have seen in real life. Here's a cartoon where relating the things you see on the front page of a university's website with the things people go to the site looking for. This cartoon, I fear, will ring true to you. And here, of course, when you draw a circle, the circle on the left is meant to represent the set of all things that are on the front page of a website, and the circle on the right is meant to represent all the things people are looking for. So where they overlap are the things that people are looking for that are actually on the website. And of course, the joke here is that the only thing that's actually there is the full name of the school. In our case, events are always subsets of the sample space, so we'll always draw a big circle or oval to represent the sample space, and then an event will be some circle or oval inside the sample space. So there are two events. You can see where they overlap. You can see what's in both of them. And when I talk about three expressions that build events from other events, compound events you can think of. So the first expression is not A. If I have an event, its complement, not A, is the event consisting of all outcomes which aren't in A. So it's everything outside the circle A. The second way of building events is AND. A and B, which is the intersection of A and B, is the event consisting of all outcomes which are in both A and in B. That's the full name of the school in the cartoon. A somewhat less intuitive notion is A or B, the union of A and B, and that's the event consisting of all outcomes which are in either A or in B or in both. These all sort of correspond roughly to English notion, but in practice they require a little bit more care than English usually requires of you. Let's do some examples in terms of probability. The event ace that you draw on an ace, its complement would be not an ace. It would be the event that you draw some card which isn't an ace. And you can see there are 48 ways of doing that in your standard deck of 52. The event ace and heart would be drawing a card which is both an ace and a heart. There's only one way to do that. That's if you draw the ace of hearts. Finally, the event ace or heart is you draw a card and it's either ace or a heart or both. How many ways are there to do that? Well, if you think about it for a moment, you will see there's 13 hearts, there's 4 aces. You might think it's 13 plus 4, but of course then you'd be counting the ace of hearts twice. So you have to subtract off 1 for that. And you see that there's a total of 16 cards, which are either an ace or a heart or both. There are rules which relate these compound events and their probabilities to the events and their probabilities themselves. These are all rules that make sense if you think of probability as being the area in a Venn diagram. One little caveat, you'll have to use units because the sample space has probability 1. You have to use units where the total area of the sample space is 1. If you do that, all of these rules make sense as rules about area. So here we want to think of the area of that gray region as being the probability of A. First of our rules is pretty simple. It's called the complement rule, and it says the probability that A is not true is 1 minus the probability that A is true. So visually, in terms of area, that's saying the area outside of A is the area of the whole sample space minus the area inside of A. And that's pretty natural. What does it mean in terms of probability? Well, for example, we saw that the probability of not drawing an ace was 48 out of 52. The 1 minus the probability of ace is 1 minus 4 out of 52, and of course, that's 48 out of 52. So it works in that case. The probability that you are not a Republican, we didn't quite calculate this before, but it's very similar, is the probability that you're a Democrat or an independent. We add up 0.261, 0.304, we get 0.565. Is that the same as 1 minus the probability that you are a Republican? Yes, it's 1 minus 0.435. So in each of those cases, the complement rule works, and hopefully they give you a feeling why it's true. The complement rule is useful in a lot of straightforward ways when you can see you're just looking at the complement of something. It's also useful occasionally when the event you're looking for is complicated and difficult to describe, but its complement is easy. So you can find the probability of the complement and then just subtract it from 1 to find the probability you really want. We'll see examples of that later. The next rule is a bit more complicated. This is the sum rule. It tells you that the probability of A or B is given by the following formula. The probability of A plus the probability of B minus the probability of A and B. Well, that takes some getting used to. It makes a little bit more sense if you think about the Venn diagrams. A or B is that sort of binocular-shaped region on the left. Its area is the area of A plus the area of B, but you can see that you've double-counted the area where they overlap. So you have to subtract off, on the far right, the area where they overlap, which is P of A and B. It will make even more sense if you look at an example. The probability of ace or heart, we saw there were 16 possibilities, so it's 16 out of 52. On the other hand, the right-hand side of the sum rule in that case is the probability of ace plus the probability of heart minus the probability of ace and hearts. Probability of drawing an ace is 4 out of 52. Probability of drawing a heart is 13 out of 52. And the probability of drawing an ace and a heart is 1 out of 52. Those are all things we calculated already. And sure enough, 4.50 seconds plus 13.50 seconds minus 1.50 second is 16.50 seconds. Notice that when we figured out there were 16 ways to draw an ace or a heart, we pretty much did this calculation. We added 4 plus 13 minus 1. So this is just expressing that idea, that you take all the things in one set, all the things in the other set, and notice that you double counted the things which are in both. Here's a simpler example. The probability that you're a Democrat or an independent, we already calculated, that's 0.565. The right-hand side here is the probability that you're a Democrat plus the probability that you're an independent minus the probability that you're both, and that's 0.261 plus 0.304 minus 0, because you can't be both a Democrat and an independent. So in this case, the sum rule worked out very simply because A and B was 0. And that happens often enough. We'll use some special terminology and refer to that as a special case directly. We say that two events, A and B, are disjoint or mutually exclusive if they can't both happen together. That is, if the probability of A and B is equal to 0. The important thing about this definition is it's, in practice, easy to recognize events which are disjoint. So, returning to my cartoon Venn diagrams, this Venn diagram of beggars and choosers doesn't overlap, expressing the fact that beggars can't be choosers. In other words, that these are mutually exclusive, disjoint events. So what are disjoint events? Being a heart and a spade are disjoint. Being a Democrat and an independent are disjoint. Rolling a 1 and rolling a 2 are disjoint. None of those can happen at the same time. On the other hand, the events ace and heart are not disjoint. You can be both an ace and a heart. You can roll an even number, and at the same time roll a number less than 3, if you roll a 2, So even and less than 3 are not disjoint. Okay? So disjoint is easy to recognize in physical situations. When events are disjoint, the third term in the sum rule, P of A and B, is 0, so you can leave it out. And the sum rule becomes much simpler. The probability, when A and B are disjoint, the probability of A or B is just the sum of the probability of A and B. So you can think of probability as turning or into plus. It's a nice visual way to think about it. And in fact, very often when you use the sum rule, it's on disjoint events. So if you like, you can think of the sum rule as hopefully turning or into plus, and when events are not disjoint, you have to patch that up by adding this extra term. I don't know if that's a helpful way of thinking about it. So, what's the probability that you draw a heart or a club? They're mutually exclusive. You add the probability of heart, probability of club, which are both a quarter, and you find that it's 1/2. What's the probability of drawing royalty, an ace or a king or a queen? They're mutually exclusive. You add up their probabilities. It's 3 out of 13. Oops. What's the probability of drawing a woman being a Democrat or an independent? You add up the probabilities because they're disjoint. All right, let's explore this in an example. Here's an example represented by a table, very much like the contingency tables we looked at relating to categorical variables. And in fact, that's not just an analogy. This is really another way of talking about contingency tables. Probability allows you to give a more subtle language for talking about contingency tables. Here's a table where the two questions we asked were whether you're a wizard or a muggle, and whether you had 2 wizard parents, 2 muggle parents, or 1 of each. We asked 100 people, and here were our answers. Of course, this isn't a real survey, just to make that clear. So we can ask a question like, in this sample, or in the population, assuming that by the empirical rule this sample is representative, what is the probability someone in the sample is a muggle? So to answer that, assuming each person in the sample is equally likely to be chosen, you count the number of people in the sample who are muggles, 72, and you divide it by the number of people in the sample, 100. And you say there's a 72% chance that a person in this sample is a muggle. Okay, so you try. What's the probability that someone had muggle parents? So the answer is, you take the 85 people who had muggle parents, divide by 100, you get 85%. All right, a little bit subtler, what's the probability someone is a squib? Those of you who read Harry Potter know that a squib is a muggle who has wizard parents. In that case, there's 1 person in the sample who's a muggle with wizard parents. So 1 out of the 100 people, there's a 1% chance that someone is a squib. All right, stepping it up a little, what's the probability someone is a muggle or has wizard parents? Try that. There are 2 ways to answer this. Straightforwardly, one could use, well, I don't know which is more straightforward. One could use the sum rule, which says the probability of muggle plus the probability of wizard parents minus the probability of muggle and wizard parents. We worked out muggle as 72%. Wizard parents we didn't work out, but it's 10 divided by 100. And we worked out probability of muggle and wizard parents, which is 1%. So 72% plus 10% minus 1% is 81%. That's one way to work it out. Another way to work it out is to just count up all the cells that meet those conditions. So these 9 people are either a muggle or have wizard parents. This person certainly is. This one person who's a muggle with mixed parents is, and the 70 muggles with muggle parents are. If you add up 70 plus 1 plus 1 plus 9, you get 81. All right, and last question. What's the probability someone has either wizard or mixed parents? Again, there are 2 ways to do this. Notice they're disjoint, so we can use the sum rule in its simple form and just add up the probability of having wizard parents with the probability of having mixed parents. So that's 10 out of 100 plus 5 out of 100, which is 15%. Here's the second way. You can notice that the complement of wizard or mixed parents is having muggle parents. It's the only other possibility. So it's 1 minus, by the complement rule, the probability of not having muggle parents. So 1 minus 85 over 100, which is 15%. Okay? So there's a case where, of course, it's pretty trivial savings, but you can save a little bit of effort by noticing that the complement of the event you want is a little bit simpler than the event itself. Okay, so what should you be able to do now? First basic thing is you should be able to check that something is a probability model. Somebody hands you a set, tells you here are the probabilities, you just have to check they're all between 0 and 1 and that they add up to 1. That is now a probability model that models something. You should be able, given a probability model, to find the probability of events. Just add up the probabilities, the outcomes that make it up. You should be able to use the complement rule, the sum rule, and the simple sum rule, and you should be able to tell when events are disjoint. After we do some examples, you should be able to solve problems that require you to apply several of the probability rules in sequence. That will become more relevant after the next lecture when we learn the last of the probability rules.